This is my song, praising my Savior. Let's do that again. Hymn number 73, just the first verse. merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Good morning, and happy Sabbath to one and all. How are you today? Amen, amen. You know, I was thinking about the weather, and I remember like 4 weeks ago we had a nice, you can be seated. We had a nice warm day, and then the following Sabbath it got cold. We had snow, I think. And then the following Sabbath, we had an 80-degree day. And then last week was warm, and then today is on the cool side. And I'm thinking, you know, sometimes life is like that. You know, there's ups and there's downs, and you know, it's ebbs and flows, and it is valleys and peaks and stuff like that. But I was thinking also about the God that we serve. And I one of the things that I can say about God is that God never changes. He's always the same. He's the same yesterday, he's the same today, and he will always be the same. And we can count on him. We can call on him. He promises us that he will answer when we call on him. So it's so good to know that we trust such a God. And I just want to welcome all today to our Sabbath worship. Those that are online are visiting us through streaming, we invite you to be part of our worship. We ask that you would we hope that you are blessed by some word or some form of worship that we will endeavor in today, that you will be blessed, and at the end of the day we ask that you'll be drawn closer to our Maker. Take care. Have a good day. Have a good Sabbath. I'm sorry. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Let's stand and let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful for this another Sabbath that you have given us. We thank you that you are an unchanging God, a God who never fails. You are the creator, you are a maker, and you love us, and you care for us. And we ask your presence in our midst as we worship you today. We ask that you will be with the speaker, with all the speakers, with all the different forms of worship that we will engage in today, and that some heart, some soul may be touched by your word. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah.
Hi everyone, it's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called A Rainbow Promise. The memory verse is from Genesis chapter 9, verse 15. It says, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Today's message is God's people rejoice because he cares for them. Has it ever rained for many days where you live? Were you getting tired of playing indoors? How did you feel when you finally saw the sun come out? Could you go out again? If so, you will understand how Noah and his family felt when they finally left the ark. After more than a year in the ark, it must have been wonderful to leave it. Noah's family stepped out into the clean, sweet air. They stood and smiled in the warm, welcoming sunshine. It was probably a bit scary, too. The world looked so different, and it was so quiet. The eight people who walked off the ark were the only people left on the entire earth. They were starting over, alone and together. Soon the animals were freed. Noah's family must have seen their joy and excitement. They must have laughed as the animals pranced and danced. When the ark was empty, the first thing Noah did was build an altar and have family worship. God was pleased by their worship and blessed the family. He said, "Be fruitful and increase in number, multiply on the earth and increase upon it." Then God gave Noah, his sons, and every generation yet to come a promise. Brilliant colors splashed across the sky in what was surely the most perfect rainbow ever. That first arch of color in the heavens must have filled the tiny family with awe and wonder. But it was more than just a beautiful display of color. It was a rainbow promise. For God said to Noah, "I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. When the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth." God knew the sight of clouds might frighten Noah's family in the days ahead. The splatter of the first raindrops might fill these survivors with fear. Would it be the start of another flood? Would they too be wiped off the earth? No, they didn't need to worry. God had given them his promise. This one special family had been through a lot together. For more than a year, they had worked together on the ark. For long days and nights, they had drifted together on an endless ocean. They had worked hard to care for all those animals, and now they were to resettle the earth and start over. God had given them something precious. He had given them the experience of the rainbow to share. It would be a blessing and a promise to treasure forever, for them and for us. We too belong to a special family. Our family of believers includes those in our churches and schools, as well as our families at home. And we too have been given a special work to do. We will go through a lot together over the years, and the experiences we share will bring us closer together. And God has given us our own rainbows, blessings, and promises. He will help us do what he has asked. Noah's family was well cared for inside and outside the ark. They were thankful to God for his love and protection. When you see a rainbow, think of God's love for you and thank him for keeping his rainbow promise and all his promises.
What does Jesus' sacrifice for you truly mean? Jesus left heaven, his comfort zone, and he embraced the plight of fallen humanity. He accomplished his mission against fearful odds and dire resistance. Finally, he offered it all, his own life. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. As God's representatives, a sacrificial spirit is part of our true identity. That was the spirit demonstrated by our church's pioneers. John Andrews, for example, was a widower with two children when he accepted a call to go to Europe as the first official Seventh-day Adventist missionary. He accepted the call without knowing what his specific salary would be. They agreed to send him money from time to time, but did not do so as regularly as needed. To publish tracts, pamphlets, and the French periodical, Le Signe des Temps, he often used his personal funds, sometimes going without food and other necessities. He contracted pneumonia in 1877. After his examination, the physician commented, "This man is almost starved to death." 1 year later, Andrew's daughter died of tuberculosis. The committed missionary nevertheless relentlessly continued his groundbreaking work until he died of tuberculosis at 54. We live in a time when money and other resources are hard to find. Waiting for surplus or leftover resources to support God's mission could be a pious, well-intended wish, but may never be accomplished. In this context, these words of Ellen White are most relevant. The absence of self-denial in his professed followers, God regards as a denial of the Christian name. Those who profess to be one with Christ and indulge their selfish desires for rich and expensive clothing, furniture, and food are Christians only in name. To be a Christian is to be Christ-like. As we return our tithe and regular and systematic offerings, which we call promise, let us show a spirit of self-denial, which is the spirit of Christ. May we put our desires last and God first.
Come before us, his throne of grace, in prayer. Shall we bow our heads? Heavenly Father, great and mighty God, we come to your throne of grace, not that we deserve it, but you just say we can, to obtain mercy in times of need. And we need you, dear Lord. We ask forgiveness for our sins, dear Lord. Cleanse us so that your Holy Spirit can be poured out on us, and Jesus will answer our prayers. Oh Lord, we pray in a very special way for those who need the blessing of health, oh Lord. We thank you for those that are improving. We pray for Brother Lashley, O Lord, and also Brother Weston, dear Lord, that you will grant them healing and renewal, dear Lord. As it is written in your word, the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he has committed sin, they shall be forgiven him. So we rest in faith for the outcome. We pray in a very special way for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Father, we pray in a very special way as you sent your Son, dear. To comfort those that mourn, as it is written, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the feeling, for the spirit of emptiness. Lord, you are an capable God, there's nothing beyond your reach, O Lord. As we ask prayer for our church, all nations, its leaders, and its congregation, and all those who are watching, Lord, we pray that we can be a beacon of hope and a beacon of light to all. Lord, we pray in a very special way that your Holy Spirit will convict the governments around the world so that their mandates and their bills will be according to your will. so that your faithful people will be able to take your gospel to the end of the world. Be with us all. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. My name is Charles Payne, but I'll be doing the scripture reading for today. It can be found in Luke 5:4-6. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your net for a catch." But Simon answered and said to him, "Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net." And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. Amen.
Voices together as we sing hymn number 8, "We Gather Together." We are gathered here together.
Last verse.
We all do extol thee, our leader triumphant, and pray that thou still our defender wilt be. Let thy congregation escape tribulation, thy name be ever praised.
Thank you, you may sit. But we shall continue to sing number 608, "Faith is the Victory." When we gather together and we hear and we share our experiences and we listen to the word, our faith grows. And this is the victory that overcomes the world. The Lord says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. And so we are working on growing our faith, because faith is the victory that overcomes the world.
Encamped along the hills of time, the Christian soldiers rise.
open skies.
Against the foe in fields below, let all our strength be heard. Faith is the battle way we know that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
On every hand,
on every hand, the foe we find
drawn up in treachery.
Let tents of peace be left behind, and onward to the fray. Salvation's helmet on each head, with truth for word about. The earth shall tremble with our tread, and echo with our shout. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
To him that overcomes?
To him that overcomes the foe, white raiment shall be given. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed in heaven. Then onward from the hills of light,
no hearts will love aflame.
We'll vanquish all the hosts of night in Jesus' conquering name. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
Amen. That was good. You guys sounded good. And now, as we journey through life, and we learn that faith is a victory, and we are overcoming in Jesus' name, what are we going to say at the end of our journey here? We hope that we'll all join together and say, it is well with our souls. Hymn 530, it is well. Thank you, Jameson, for accompanying us. This is our son, our youngest, and we are very happy that he's here with us today. When peace like a river.
It is well with my he rose back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
It is well
with my soul.
With my soul, it is well. It is well with my soul.
Thank you.
A little bit better than that. Good morning and happy Sabbath, all nations. Before we get into the message, shall we pray? Lord, I don't want to get in your way today, but I'm broken. So I pray that you would speak through me. I pray that your words will be heard. And your Holy Spirit will dwell in us and change us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to apologize for my dress. Normally I would have on a suit. And I want to apologize for, even though someone will say don't apologize for your tears, I want to apologize for my emotions. Today is a hard day for me. Today would have been Kat's fourth birthday. So I ask that you would continually lift Roxanne and I in prayer as we navigate life. Turn with me in your Bibles, though, to Luke chapter 5. And it is not my intention to loiter today with the message, so I just want to be briefly, I want to make this as brief as possible. I want to visit a familiar passage of Scripture, Luke chapter 5, and dissect just the bit of tissue that you can chew on throughout the week. Luke chapter 5, we're going to look at verses 4 through 6. And while I was looking at this passage, there was no two or three themes or titles that ran through my mind, only one word. Thus, the topic and title of the message today is simply capacity. Capacity. Luke chapter 5, verses 4 through 6. I will be reading in your hearing. I'm reading from the King James Version. So if yours say something differently, just know that I'm using a different translation. Now, when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. Capacity. Capacity is often confused with the amount something requires to be filled. The capacity of the room, the capacity of the tank. Your lungs have a capacity. Your heart, your stomach, your car all have a capacity. And by definition, capacity is the maximum amount that something can contain, but capacity is also defined as the amount that something can produce. The capacity of the apple tree, capacity of the battery, the truck's towing capacity, the capacity of your faith. What is your capacity, church? How much can you hold? Conversely, how much can you produce? We often live our lives on the notion of determining how much we can contain, but I realized as I was doing preparation that I never considered how much I can produce. What can be withdrawn from you? What is the weight of the influence that you produce? What is your capacity. And I think that because we often misdefine the word, we then limit our capacity to hold and contain, as well as our ability to produce at a level of abundance. And this is where we find Simon Peter, along with James and John, the sons of Zebedee, mending their nets in order to be able to catch fish to the net's capacity. And to understand the story a little bit more, it is helpful to go back and look at the narrative. In those days, it was generally generational, your occupation. My father was a fisherman, I would be a fisherman. My father was a farmer or a carpenter or a tax collector, that would be my occupation. The same is with Peter, James, and John. Their father was a fisherman. So their capacity in the world, in their society, was to catch fish. Even Jesus was referred to as a carpenter because his father Joseph was a carpenter. And here's some men in the tradition of following in their father's footsteps are Peter, Andrew, James, and John. And with most fishermen of the day, they didn't have rod and reel. They had nets, baskets, spears, hook and line, and even with their bare hands, they would catch fish. Fishing was hard work, especially for fishermen who stood on the banks and threw their nets into the sea and drug it in. There was nothing awe-inspiring about being a fisherman. There was no glory, no praise, no honor, no best seats in the synagogue. They carried no real influence in society. They were ordinary people doing ordinary work. Fishermen usually fished at night because the fish would see the shadow of the boat and the shadow of the net in the daytime. So fishing at night was best because the fish usually were eating. And so that was the best time to cast their nets. In the morning, they would draw their catch to shore and they would sort through and haul and take it to the fish gate or the fish market, and they would sell what they caught. And because fish was the most common food for people, the demand was high. And while they're sitting on the banks, fixing their nets, the Bible says that Jesus had been going about his ministry. And he comes to the Lake of Gennesaret, and the people are pressed around Jesus, and they want to hear the word of the Lord. Jesus, coming to the lake, sees two boats, and he goes on Peter's boat, and he asks Peter to push out just a little bit from shore. Fisherman, just take me out a little bit. Not much, just a little bit. The people are pressing. I just want to get back a little bit. Bible says while they were sitting here working, after long nights of work, they have caught nothing, not a trout, not a bass, not a mullet, not a sardine. To be at it all night and have nothing to show for it. Not one of my famous writers, but one of the most influential writers, he would probably put it this way: not one fish, two fish, red fish, blue fish. Black fish, blue fish, old fish, new fish. Not a fish with a star, not a fish with a little car. Say, what a lot of fish there are, but none were in their boats. They caught nothing at all. And it is not that they have worked lazily, says Elder Anna. It's not that they were just out there casting the net any kind of way. No, they were tossing and pulling and tossing and pulling and heaving and pulling and fixing and tossing all night long. It is one thing to have your output match your input, but it is another thing entirely to give something all of you and reap no benefit. If you invest yourself in a business, yet you reap no profit, or you open yourself up in a friendship, yet you gain no closeness, if you pay to eat at a buffet and you still leave hungry, it is a difficult thing when you try and fill your capacity only to end up with nothing. I want you to understand that the nets have been designed to hold a specific capacity. The amount of fish that it could hold was tailored to meet the amount of fish that the ship could carry. The capacity of the net was also matched with the capacity of the fisherman, for it would be a foolish thing to give a weak fisherman a strong net. He needed to be able to heave it out into the sea. It needed to have weights attached so it would sink. It needed to be able to hold and pull in the fish as they struggled to get away. The fisherman had to be matched with the net. The net had to be matched with the fish. The ship had to be matched with the weight. The Bible says, although everything was synced, although everything was aligned, although everything was perfect, catch after catch, they caught nothing. And now they're sitting on the shore, mending their nets. And here comes Jesus and a multitude. Great, Peter mutters. Being Peter, there were probably some other choice words, but I won't say that. Great. Here come all these people, and we have nothing to sell them. Have you ever been in a position where you feel insufficient? People are there trying to get something from you, but you don't have anything to give. People want your help or your prayers, and you feel that you have no connection with God. I recall many times my brother would call and say, hey, bro, can you loan me $20? And I open up my Chase account. And I'm like, I got $7, bro. I can Cash App it to you. Oh, I don't have Cash App. Have you ever been in a place where people are expecting something from you and you have nothing? In comes Jesus, fisherman by trade, would normally sell their fish on the shore. In a place where they could be effective, they can't produce. And Jesus, the Bible says, enters into Peter's ships and bid that he only goes out a little bit from the land so that he can teach the people without being encumbered. And I begin to wonder, what if they had caught a little bit of fish? Not a lot of fish, just a little bit. Would they still have allowed Jesus to come onto the vessel? If they had caught maybe one ship full, they would have been doing something else. Their nets would not be mending. They would be scaling. They would be sorting. They would be cleaning it and saying, oh, we have this for sale. We have that for sale. Hey, Andrew, you need to take this over to this market. And John, you need to take it over to this market. But they have caught nothing. And as I pondered on the passage in preparation, I concluded that we often miss the opportunity to discover our capacity simply because we are happy with the level of occupancy we are at. Take a breath. Let it out. Take another breath and let it out. So one, did you realize that your lungs can hold more than what you took in the first two times? Take in the biggest breath that you can. Now let it out. Feels different. Because you are now trying to fill your lungs to its capacity. Oftentimes, however, we never try to reach our highest point because we're satisfied with good. One writer, James Collins, author of the books How the Mighty Fall and Good to Great, he penned these words, good is the enemy of great. And that is one of the key reasons why we have so little that becomes great. We don't have great schools principally because we have good schools. We don't have great government principally because we have good government. Few people, he concludes, attain great lives in part because it is just so easy to settle for a good life. And the same can be said about one's capacity and one's ability to be filled and or produce. We have not yet mastered a thing or reached our full potential or filled our vessel to capacity simply because it's easier just to do it halfway. I don't have a lot of money, but I have enough. My kids aren't the smartest, but they're not stupid either. They can understand. They can make it. My church is really not thriving and engaged in the community, but we still have Sabbath services. I don't pray like I used to or need to, but God still hears me. I don't love the same way. I don't love to my max. I don't give compassion to my max. I am satisfied with being good. And what we find in the passage is that what happened to them the last night begins to affect their capacity to fish the next day. For the Bible says that of the two ships, Jesus enters Peter's ships and he bids them that he goes out just a little bit from the land so he can teach. And the Bible says that when Jesus is done teaching the people, he turns his attention to Peter, who is now finished mending his nets. And he says, hey, go out into the deep and cast your net into the draught. Peter looks at Jesus. He says, "You don't know what we've been doing last night. My nets were cast all night long, and we caught nothing." He says, "My capacity level is low. I cannot contain anything else in my nets. If I try to fill a cup with holes, the cup will continue to drain itself of the contents, because what affected me yesterday will limit me today. There are psychological barriers that will hinder my capacity if I don't address the root of yesterday's issues." That's why people who are in bad relationships, they often end up in other bad relationships, in other bad relationships. People who leave debt churches normally go to other debt churches, because we never really heal our nets. "I'm okay. I'll just bear through it. My cup isn't fully drained. I still have a little bit left. The holes were only at the top. That was only when I was six. I won't worry about what they said to me. I won't try and fix the relationship I had with my father who was never there, or my mother who was absent, or my brothers who didn't love me. I won't even deal with it, because I can still manage a little bit to get me by." Capacity. Tyrone said he loved me, but he left me for Keisha. And now when you say that you love me, my capacity to give you love is now affected by Tyrone. When we say, "Hey, come and minister and come and help us in this ministry," because of what happened to you 5-10 years at another church, now you're saying, "No, I don't want to get burnt again. I don't want to pour myself out, because if I pour 100% and you pour 50, now we have a problem." Capacity. And here is Peter looking at Jesus, who is directing him to go back to where he just came from, with the same boat, with the same net, with the same people. It's funny how God will make us redo things. He never changes the tools that he gives us. He simply sends us back to go do it again. Peter is trying to make Jesus understand that it does not matter if he goes back out, because it's daytime now. Here is this carpenter teacher telling me how to fish. My daddy was a fisherman. His father was a fisherman. His father before him. And you want to tell me to go back in the daytime? The gulls are in the air. The fish can see my boat coming through the water. They will see my net. It will be useless. However, I'll go because you said to go. Now they're back in the same boat, on the same lake, with the same people, holding the same nets that had failed them before. It's a hard thing to trust the same things that failed you. You doubt me? Find out that a coworker is talking about you. And then you have to work with them on a project. If a family member has stolen something from you, and now at Thanksgiving dinner, they have you sitting eye to eye with the person, and they're just grinning along, acting like nothing ever happened, it is hard to trust things that have failed you. And Jesus, in verse 4, after he has done speaking to the people, he does not say, "Thanks for letting me use your boat." He doesn't say, "Just drop me back off at shore." He says, "Simon, let's go out into the deep. Let down your nets for a catch." Peter, despite logic, despite his failures of his past, he pushes out and he says, "I'll just throw it out and show this teacher that nothing will be caught. You have toiled all night. You had a great sermon, by the way, Jesus, but I'll go out to the deep." The Bible says in verse 6, when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes and their net broke. The very thing that they had just been repairing failed. This was supposed to be the vessel that caused them to increase, and now breaking as it is stretching beyond its capacity. This was the position that was supposed to take you to the next level, and now someone else has it. They were supposed to be the one to be your helper and bring you into deeper, constant relationship with God, and now the relationship is on rocky terms. This thing was supposed to be that thing, and now the net is breaking. The Bible says Peter calls to the other ship and says, come help, come help. And the Bible says in verse 7 that when the other ship gets there, they both filled the ship and the ships began to sink. Nets that were designed to only hold so much fish now contain more fish than two ships could handle. Watch this, because I don't want to linger here. The Bible says that the other ship comes, they fill both ships. The ships begin to sink. Peter looks at Jesus and he worships. He says, man, no. I am not worthy of this. I am not worthy of this. And I can give you point after point on the overflow of God and the blessings due because you step out on faith. And we could expound on how God will do exceedingly above all that you can ask of him, and how God searches the earth to find someone faithful who he can show himself strong in. But in the ritual of dissecting and feeding you multiple points from the passage, I felt that it was best directed to give you only one point. And that is, perhaps God is shifting you from being ready to receive to being ready to pour. Because remember, capacity is not just the maximum that you can hold, it is also the maximum that you can produce. Verse 8, and when Peter sees what is happening to the ships and the nets and how they have caught more in one day than they have ever done in their lifetime of fishing, he falls down at Jesus' knees, for he was astonished and all that were with him at the capacity of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus says to Simon, here it is, fear not, because henceforth after this, thou shalt catch men. You used to be a fisherman, catching fish and trout and mullet, catfish and tossing them back. You used to do this, but now I'm going to alter your capacity. You used to be able to receive what the ocean gave you in abundance, but now I'm shifting your capacity to now pour out into people and fish for men. And here's the shift. The Bible says they get back to land and they leave not only their boats, they leave the nets that they just mended, and they leave the fish they just caught. And I get it. Pouring out into someone else is a daunting thing, because in all seriousness, it took me a while to get to the place where I could give without expectation. I had to overcome some hardships, some failures, some betrayals, some damages, broken hearts, and people have overlooked me, and I felt that I should have gotten this, and this should have happened in my life, and this person should have been here, and this person maybe should have been moved out of the way. And what I've learned to realize is that God is preparing me to pour. Oftentimes, our prayer is, Lord, fill me so that I can be filled. And I begin to wonder, why isn't God filling me? I'm telling God that my cup is only so full. He knows what's in my bank account. He knows what's in my house. He knows my needs. He knows how uncomfortable my bed can be at sometimes. Lord, fill me. You know the job that I work at. Give me something better. And what I've come to realize is that God will not fill us if we're simply going to hold what he gives us. There's a tank of water sitting outside that I've been collecting rainwater to garden with. Sooner or later, the water won't be good anymore. If it sits long enough in the container, the water will lose its nutrient properties and I will have to drain it and refill it. If God gives you so much blessings and you do nothing with it, if God fills the church and we do nothing with it, if God gives you that job and you do nothing with it, if God heals your children yet you do nothing with them, where's the capacity? So God is saying, I know you want to receive, but why do you want to receive? Are you receiving just to build a bigger barn, or are you receiving to pour out to people in need? Peter, you've been fishing all these years, but now I'm going to shift you to be a fisher of men. I'm closing. Ephesians 3, 17 through 20. It made me look at this passage a little differently, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, and depth, and height, capacity, and to know the love of God which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Verse 20, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. Here's what I don't want you to do, church. Don't take verse 20 as an internal thing. Read verse 20 as something that you're now pouring outside of you. You can take verse 17 through 19 as something that God has given you. But when you get down to verse 20, think about it and, okay, God has already poured into me. Now, unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that I can ask, let me go and pour out on this community. And God says, I can do more than that. I'm going to use you to bless the whole county. Let me go out here and start a food pantry ministry. And God says, I can do more than that. You're going to feed the masses and generations. You say, oh, let me go out here and sing praise team. And God says, I can do more than that. The people in the church are the only ones who will hear you testifying, but people everywhere. God wants to do more through you and I. What is your capacity, church? Are you limiting God by your own expectations? So my prayer and my appeal to you is simple today, is that you will allow God to expand what he does in your life for the sake of others. It is not for your sake. It is not for your glory or your benefit. It is not so your kids can eat good after you're gone. What God is going to do for you, I feel that what God is going to do for you, church, is for the world. And if we don't expand our capacity to pour out into others, we will miss the biggest blessing of our lives. Because now unto him who is able, and not just able, but ready. God says, I am right here. I'm at the window. I have the blessing in my hand. I want to pour it out on you. But I can't. Because you've built barns to catch the blessings and hold them. You've built tabernacles to hide the blessings from the community. God says, I won't pour it out until you're ready to pour as well. Shift your capacity so that God's name will be glorified. Shall we pray? Lord, as you did with Peter, shift our capacity today. I know we ask all the time for you to fill us, but Lord, we don't just want to be filled for our sakes. Fill us, Lord, so that others can feel the downpouring of your blessing. Teach us to be selfless, to be willing to give the very thing that you gave us, to clothe the naked, to feed the hungry, to love the oppressed, to visit the person in prison, to take the stranger in. For your name's sake and glory, Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Message. Wow, I was blessed. I hope everyone else was as well.
God gives us small tasks to prepare us for the bigger tasks, capacity. I want to thank everyone that came here today, in person and online. Just a few quick reminders that every Wednesday at 7 p.m., we have a prayer meeting online via Zoom. Check your emails for the Zoom link, or contact us if you want to join so we can send it to you. In addition, we do run a pantry every second and fourth Sabbath. Next week, between 3 to 5, the pantry will be open for distribution of foods. Please come and join us to help give out foods, or if you know someone that needs food, that is hungry, let them know. Let them know that we're open. Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we have come to the end of our worship, and we want to thank you for enabling us to be here from the beginning to the end. Thank you for touching our lives in ways we cannot explain. You have taken us from the realms of your glory, and we want to say thank you. As we depart to our homes and various destinations, we ask you that you send us the Holy Spirit and keep us safe this day and throughout the week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Happy Sabbath.